Good morning and welcome to worship at Glebe-St.James United Church in Ottawa, Canada. We're so glad that you're here with us and we're so glad to be here with you. Today is the fourth Sunday in creation. My name is Chris Burbridge and I'm a member of the worship committee here. Glebe-St.James is an affirming congregation in the United Church of Canada. Everyone in their gender, race, ethnicity, abilities, or sexual orientation is welcome and celebrated here. As we meet, we remember in gratitude the Algonquin peoples on whose traditional, unceded, unsurrendered land our sanctuary stands. We acknowledge their story and their stewardship of the land, water, plants, and animals through many generations. McGwich. We are so glad to have you join us from your homes, your cottages, and wherever you may be at the moment. Whether you are watching alone or with family, we invite you to take a moment to create a worship space around you. Light a candle. Quiet your mind. Know that you are not alone. The bulletin for today's worship service can be found on the Glebe-St.James website. The bulletin includes the order of service and all of this week's announcements. Prayer responses and hymn lyrics will be shown on the screen. On the website, you'll also find a link to the donate button to make your offering. The work of the church continues in our community. That work and the live streaming of worship services like this, as they say, are made possible by viewers like you. Glebe-St.James will remain closed for at least the next month due to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. This week, members of our congregation received a questionnaire about reopening and other related matters. We ask that you complete and return the questionnaire as soon as possible so that Council can make appropriate decisions about going forward. Your opinions play an important role in this matter. Stephanie Langell, our Minister of Christian Development, was up early this morning for Children's Church. They meet at 9 a.m. on Sunday mornings in their own Zoom meeting. If your child is interested in joining, please contact the church office for the information. Our audio-visual tech team is looking for recruits. We are looking for people young or old who are comfortable with technology and interested in learning more about what goes into presenting our worship services. And you can contact me directly by email. And this week we want to say a special thank you to Eric, who has worked night and day, and we are here this morning. So thank you, Eric. This Wednesday, September 30th, is Orange Shirt Day, an initiative affirming that every child matters. It shines light on the residential school experience, witnessing and honoring the healing journey of the survivors and their families, and committing to the ongoing process of reconciliation. If you have an orange shirt, please join us on Wednesday by wearing it. Next Sunday, October 4th, from 1 to 4 p.m., the Ottawa Centretown Church's Social Action Committee will be hosting the virtual walk for the Centretown Emergency Food Center. This is an important resource that many in our faith community actively support. For more information on how you can participate, please go to the committee's website. Next week, we'll be marking the Feast of St. Francis of Assisi. Stephanie is preparing something special, and she'd like us to send her pictures of our pets or the wild animals we like to watch. Next week, we will also be celebrating World Communion Sunday. When you are preparing to watch the worship service, have a piece of bread or a roll and your favorite beverage at hand so you can participate in the sacrament of communion. And there are many more announcements, and I invite you to stay tuned to the slides after the service or to check in the bulletin. This week, we're happy to be led in worship by our minister, the Reverend Teresa Burnett Cole, and happy to have Teresa and Ruth back in our midst with their negative test results. James Caswell, our Minister of Music, and Julia, Jessica, and Donna Fay will lead us in music. Stephanie Langill will have a children's story. Now let us bring our hearts and minds together in worship.
As we light this candle, we remember the light and the love of Jesus Christ, and the love and the light of the one who sent him.
That light shines in us and through us in all that we do and all that we are. This morning, the sun's first rays called the day into light. Did you hear the chatter and the song of the birds breaking the silence of the pre-dawn night? Did you see the colors of dawn stretched across the heavens? Did you feel the cool night air shifting to a morning breeze? Creation is stirring. Our day has begun. Some of us woke from a peaceful slumber, refreshed and renewed. Or perhaps it was a long, endless night of sleep-deprived hours, or even the tormented dreams of a restless mind. Yet here we are, all of us together, to celebrate, to worship, and love God. So whether reluctant or joyful, weary or rested, we raise our voices in song and praise. Pray. Creating One, here we are, a virtual gathering of your people. Okay. This is where you're supposed to have a paper copy. Let's try that again. Creating One, here we are, a virtual gathering of your people. Evidence of creation's unfolding, we come all shapes and sizes, all ages and life stages. We come on dancing feet, or carefully walking. We come hesitant and unsure, or filled with conviction and knowing our way. However we come, we're here to join with all of creation in praise and thanksgiving. Accept our gift of worship as one voice, one hope, one love, as we gather into praise. Amen.
Thank you to Chris for that lovely slide, reminding everyone, if you have a pet or an animal that is important in your life, don't be shy, send me a picture, and we're going to use it this time next week. Today, we are talking about the Orange Shirt Day Project. We wear orange shirts on September 30th, which falls on a Wednesday this year, to honor the children who survived the residential school system and remember those who didn't. We recognize the harm residential schools did to our First Nations children, their sense of self-worth, sense of self-esteem, and their sense of well-being. And we commit to ensure that every child matters. Today I have a story that is written by Phyllis Webstad, who is a survivor of the residential school system. And this is a simplified version for younger children. Phyllis's orange shirt. Little Phyllis lived with her granny on the Dog Creek Reserve. They would pick berries, garden, and catch fish to preserve. There were not many kids with whom Phyllis could play because they went to residential school far, far away. One day, Granny took Phyllis to town. It was exciting to see so many people around. Granny took Phyllis to a shop full of clothes, with hats for your head and socks for your toes. Phyllis picked out a shirt that was so orange, shiny, and bright, and Granny brought it for her to wear with delight. On the first day of residential school, Phyllis just couldn't wait. She wore her orange shirt so that she would look great. But when she arrived, her mood started to change. The place was so cold, unfriendly, and strange. Her bright orange shirt was taken away, and she worried about how long she would stay. At public school, she was taught how to read and write neatly by a teacher who treated her so very sweetly. Phyllis liked her teacher, but missed her granny so bad, along with the garden and home that she had. And when, finally, summer arrived, Phyllis returned to the home where she thrived. We wear our orange shirts to remember that every child matters, and not just in September. We honor First Nations people and reflect on how every child is special and deserves our respect. Let us pray. Get comfortable. Take a big deep breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. Holy One, when we know better, we do better. Help us to open our eyes, our hearts, and minds to injustice. Help us to stick with the hard work of reconciliation for a better tomorrow. Amen.
A reading from the book of Job, chapter 38. Now finally, God answered Job from the eye of a violent storm. He said, "Where were you when I created the earth? Tell me, since you know so much. Who decided on its size? Certainly you'll know that. Who came up with the blueprints and measurements? How was its foundation poured? And who set the cornerstone? While the morning stars sang in chorus and all the angels shouted praise. And who took charge of the ocean when it gushed forth like a baby from the womb? Who do you suppose carves canyons for the downpours of rain and charts the route of thunderstorms that bring water to unvisited fields, desert no one ever lays eyes on, drenching the useless wastelands so they're carpeted with wildflowers and grass? And who do you think is the father of rain and dew, the mother of ice and frost? You don't for a minute imagine these marvels of weather just happened, do you? Can you catch the eye of the beautiful Pleiades sisters or distract Orion from his hunt? Can you get Venus to look your way or get the Great Bear and her cubs to come out and play? Do you know the first thing about the sky's constellations and how they affect things on Earth? This is wisdom from our ancestors in faith.
In Job 38, we have a wonderful statement of who God is. We have a wonderful statement about his tremendous power and the power of creation. I'm having trouble with my teleprompter. Let me start again. In Job 38, we have a wonderful statement of God. About his tremendous power and the power of creation. How wonderful is our God in the marvelous creation of this universe. We want to realize what God has done for us. And in Job 38, we read, "Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins. I'll question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Well, surely you know. Who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy?" So then God speaks of the creation of the world, and he asks Job, "Where were you at this time?" All the questions of God that God asks about the tremendous universe and the greatness of our God. Today, scientists are discovering something of the wonders of the universe. There are tremendous findings today that are simply amazing. For instance, there are photographs of the Palomar Observatory in this new sky survey that's revealing for the first time very faint, luminous patches of dust and gas. Now, out there in space, we've read about suns. We've read about planets that revolve around the suns. We, of course, have heard of the great Milky Way, consisting of suns and their planets revolving around them, and millions of great Milky Ways out there in space. We've also read about comets. We've read about asteroids, which are little baby stars, very small. Now astronomy is finding out there in space there are these patches of dust and gas. And astronomers have suspected that this material was there because it actually altered the light of the stars that were trying to shine through from behind. The light is troubled and can't get through very well, because something hinders the light from coming through. They suspected that it was dust and gas, and now the photographs confirm that it indeed is dust and gas. So what makes these patches of dust and gas glow? Well, there are two possibilities, apparently. One is reflected light from nearby stars. Perhaps when the gas is excited by ultraviolet radiation of a very hot star, that is like an enormous neon light, then it glows. A real hot star exciting the gas nearby may create the glow. But there's one thing for sure. There are dark curtains of matter hiding vast areas, and they're having difficulty photographing them. Some of these patches of interstellar matter, that is the matter between stars, hide the stars behind them. And in some parts of the sky where the stars are few, they cannot tell whether the empty spot is simply the absence of stars or because there's a dark patch blotting out the view. They just don't know which of the two is true. One thing they know, there's dust and gas out there in space. Another interesting thing is the different types of stars that the astronomers have discovered. God made the stars also, the Bible says, and he made different types. So some are yellow stars, like our sun. Then there are those giant blue and red stars, some so large that if their center was our sun's center, they would envelop the Earth in their vast interior, many, many times greater than our sun. Then there are the pale stars. There are pulsating giant stars which daily swell and contract. We know this to be a fact. There are also pairs of stars that revolve around each other. Now, God says he calls them all by their names. Now, I find that kind of interesting. Something else interesting to the scientific mind and to the Christian today in God's creation and astronomy is the birth of stars. Some are thought to be old, stable suns, as old as the galaxy itself. Some of the brighter stars, the blue giants, are believed to be comparatively young, for they spend their energy so fast that they can't live long, only for a few million years. And that's not long for a star. You know, the study of age is itself an interesting study. Why do things live only a little while and die? Not long ago, a friend of mine was talking about a dog that he'd had, and he said it lived for 16 years and then it passed away. The lifespan of the dog is not the lifespan of a human being. Other creatures have shorter and some longer lifespans. But the lifespan of a star is very, very long in God's economy. But there are some that spend their energy so fast they can't live long. Only a few million years. That seems like a long time to us, doesn't it? If they were as old as the other stars, they would have burned out long, long ago. So there must be young stars. And that leads to the thought of the birth and death of stars. Now, God said he made the stars, and God calls them each by name. God numbers them, and he has that name for every single one of them. Astronomers suspect, and here we're dealing in the realm of theory, astronomers suspect that concerning the birth of death and stars, they're actually in the process of continuous birth and death. And they spend energy so fast that they actually burn out in a short time. And as the old ones burn out and die, perhaps others are being created, kind of like the repopulation of the world. One generation is moving on, is passing away. Another generation is coming on. And maybe the stars are like that too. They may be born from the contracting clouds of matter in interstellar space. This dust and gas that scientists have discovered may really be the birthplace of stars. Now, God says he made the stars. So if they're made, then God made them. We read in Hebrews 1 that Christ upholds all things by the word of his power. So Christ is actually the one behind the birth and death of stars. Christ, one with the Creator, recreates them. He is the creator and sustainer of the universe. You know, in Colossians, we read that in Christ, all things, literally all things, hold together. So it's Jesus who holds together this tremendous universe. And without Christ, there would be chaos, and there would be absolute destruction. Now, one theory about this matter of the birth and death of stars is that perhaps particles in interstellar space are pushed together at first by the pressure of light from nearby stars. And then when a certain density is reached, gravitational attraction pulls together the particles even tighter. And then with this, there's a rise in temperature, and eventually the contracting mass becomes so self-luminous that it becomes a star. Now, that's a theory, and the scientists say so. They're not positive. It isn't proven because we haven't been to a star yet. But that's what they think about the birth of stars. Now, personally, I think God may indeed use that method of birthing stars. But I remember what Scripture says, God made the stars. Doesn't say how he did it. Just says that he did. And in Christ, in whom all things are held together, is creation. Jesus Christ was back there, way back at the beginning. You remember what the Gospel of John starts, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by God, and without God, not anything made that was made. All things are made by God now, from the stars to the tiny toes of a newborn babe. All things made by God. Now, it makes perfect sense to me that Jesus is also our creator, that the one who made the heavens and the earth is the one who takes care of us. We can trust Christ in life, and we can trust Christ in death. And Christ will take us home when we've breathed our last breath to be with himself and God the Father. In some regions, friends, where there's heavy concentrations of dust, a certain astronomer has found these small nebulous, which means cloud-like, globules, small drops of matter, which he thinks are baby stars in the process of being born. It's kind of like eggs growing inside a hen. Isn't that interesting? They have some photographs showing where these embryo stars are located. And the plan is later, they're going to keep checking to see the birth of those little stars. How wonderful and how lucky are we that the one who brings birth to stars also gives birth to us. God is the one who created us, and we are the work of the Creator's hands. The stars were born, the stars die. Thank God we're born, but we never die. We live forever. Now, we indeed die physically, but we go immediately to be with Christ. Our bodies die, but our souls never do, for we are the Lord's, and eternal life is the gift that we've been given. So when the sun is old, and the moon grows cold, and the leaves of the judgment book unfold, we need not fear, for we shall be safe with our Creator and all those we love. For we do indeed, my friends, belong to Christ. Amen. Stir in us, open our hearts that we might see all of creation's glory. Open our hearts that we may know life is holy. Open our hearts that we may love with wonder and awe and reverence. Creating one we love, that we live within creation, all woven together by the sacred breath of life. And we confess the times we have chosen to forget. Name to you our careless greed, when habitat has been denied, when invasive species have been introduced, when thoughtless destruction has been allowed, even encouraged. We name to you the flight of the geese, the thump of the bullfrogs, the discreet beauty of the painted turtle, the majesty of elm trees, and the upright strength of the ash. All of your creation is diminished and threatened by our disinterest, by our complacent greed. Forgive us. Help us to discover the second chance of growing awareness, a deepened understanding and active love. May we live wisely with reverence for creation. May we live gently on this earth, giving room, sharing space, providing for all. We celebrate the steps taken to redeem this earth. The tall grass prairie replanted, the wild turkeys returned, groves of trees reestablished. Bless us as we better love your creation. To you we give our praise and thanksgiving for all that delights, for all that teaches, for all that is wondrous, for all of creation, and we thank you. Creating God, we offer our prayers for humanity, for broken hearts and wounded spirits, for moments requiring strength and courage for our daily needs. In particular this day, Holy One, we remember the children. The children who went to residential schools, for all the parents and grandparents who survived the schools and struggle to bring up the next generations. We've injured your creation here too, Holy One. And we remember them this day and always. We remember those who are ill and who are suffering, and all in our community who need support. Holy One, we gather all of our prayers into one by praying together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Mother and Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. more deeply. Know, my friends, that you are never alone, even in the isolation of the pandemic. For God, the source of love, Jesus, the love incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, love's promise and comfort, are with us each and every step of the way. And let the people say, amen indeed.